Sto.
Quindi. Ok. So welcome to the speaker Andres Rojas. He's going to talk about geometry of prime semiconical pencils. Please.
Okay, so first of all, let me thank the organizers for this school and for the opportunity to give this talk. Everything that I will explain is part of a joint work with Martí Laoz and Juan Carlos Naranjo. So first of all, let me give a brief introduction to the problem. Assume that we have a double lethal cover of a smooth curve C of genus G. Since the double cover is lethal, the genus of C tilde is 2G minus 1. Then we attach to it the prime variety as the connected component of the kernel of the norm map, which passes through the origin of the Jacobian of C tilde, and then it comes with a principal polarization. This is the definition that we have just seen today. And then if one wants to consider the canonical model of this theta divisor, in the same way as in the case of a Jacobian, one considers the canonical theta divisor in a torsor, in a translate of the original abelian variety, in this case of the original Jacobian, we can do the same if we want a canonical model of this, of this theta divisor. Okay, is this canonical model C plus, which lives in a translate of the Jacobian of C tilde. In this canonical model, the theta divisor is recovered as the intersection of the prime variety with the canonical theta divisor of the curve C. But actually, this intersection is not reduced, so one gets twice a principal polarization. Then Manford used this canonical model to classify the singularities of this theta divisor into two types: stable and exceptional. Somehow stable correspond to line bundles with at least four global sections. These are points that have a high multiplicity at points in this canonical theta divisor. So when we intersect, we still have a singular point. And the exceptional singularity is a special condition of at points where this prime variety and this canonical theta divisor somehow are tangent to each other. So we are getting a special configuration to get a singularity. And these exceptional singularities are described as follows. We have the pullback of a line bundle L on C with at least two global sections twisted by an effective divisor on the curve C. The most elementary example of exceptional singularity is when we are pulling back a semi-canonical pencil of the base curve C, such that the pullback has an even number of global sections. So for me, a semi-canonical pencil on the curve C is a theta characteristic. So it's a line bundle of degree G minus one, such that its square is isomorphic to the canonical sheaf of C. And it is an even theta characteristic, which is effective. So it has an even number of global sections, which is greater or equal than two, is positive. Okay, under this condition, we have an exceptional singularity. So Bovill used in the case of genus five, let me relate this construction with the work of Bovill, used the prime map on genus five or its proper version by admissible covers to prove that the Andreotti-Mayer locus in A4 is the union of two reducible divisors. Okay, this is the Andreotti-Mayer locus in A4, which is the divisor, is the locus of principally polarized abelian varieties, which have a singular theta divisor. And Bovill showed that the two irreducible components of this Andreotti-Mayer locus are J4, which are the Jacobians of curves of genus 4, and the divisor theta null, which parametrizes principally polarized abelian varieties, whose theta divisor contains not only a singular point, but a point which is two torsion, singular. Okay, So the key point, especially for the irreducibility of tetanol, was proving that the preimage by the pre-map, which in this genus is, when one considers the proper version, is surjective. This preimage of tetanol, which is the locus of curves satisfying this condition above, of a semicanonical pencil which pulls back to an even number of global sections. This is the preimage, and this preimage is irreducible. So that when we apply the pre-map, we get the device of tetanol, and it's irreducible. So we consider for an arbitrary genus G, two loci. The loci, we will call it TEG, of smooth covers of curves of genus G, such that the base curve has a semicanonical pencil whose pullback has an even number of global sections. So this is the same condition that we were stating above, just in an arbitrary genus. And it's also natural to consider what happens if the number of global sections of the pullback is so. So this gives to another locus that we call TOG. Okay. So these two loci are irreducible divisors of IV. And well, their closures in the delineation for compactification, RG bar, are also well known. Okay, this appeared in a recent work with Carlos Maestro. So now the natural question is, if we have these two loci, we wonder about the behavior of the pre-map restricted to these two divisors. Okay. And well, this has been already studied in two particular cases. As I told you, Bobil studied the even case of genus 5, T5V, to prove that determine the Andreotti Mayer locus in E4. And also, incidentally, in a work of Izadi, she proved that TO5, the odd case of genus 5, dominates the whole A4. The whole model space A4. So in the genus 5 case, we see that there are a big difference between these two divisors at the level of the prim map, because we call that Bobil showed that this is mapped to tetanol, to a divisor of A4. And on the other hand, we have TO5 dominating the whole A4. So this is a very different behavior. And actually, this is the situation in general. So for every G, what we will have is that the even case, the even divisor TEG is mapped to tetanol. And this is not very difficult to prove. It actually follows from the very definition. But what happens is that TOG, the odd divisors, dominate AG as long as the dimension allows it. So for low dimensions, between 3 and 5, TOG is dominating AG minus 1. Okay, and actually for higher genus, there are also differences, but we will concentrate in these cases. And specifically, I will talk just to illustrate these differences about the even cases TEG in general, the relation to tetanol, and two particular cases of odd semicanonical pencils, which are in genus 4 and genus 5. Somehow are the ones which geometrically are richer. Okay, so let us now consider the divisors, the even divisors TEG. The notation tetanol will stand not only for A4, but also in general. It will mean the divisor of principally polarized abelian varieties with a theta divisor that contains a two torsion singular point. So then in general, the preimage of this divisor by the pre-map is essentially TEG. Okay? In the cases of low genus up to genus 5, this preimage is exactly TEG. Recall that in genus 5, this is Bobil. For genus greater or equal than 6, we have TEG plus some irreducible components of codimension 3. Okay, but essentially TEG is the divisorial component of the preimage. Okay. So let me also point out that in these irreducible components, what is happening is that the prim variety, associated abelian variety, not only has a two torsion singular point, but also it contains a two torsion point, the theta divisor, with multiplicity at least three. Okay. So it's a configuration that gives a more singular theta divisor. Okay. So rather than giving a proof of this, which is not very difficult, it's just following the classification of Manford, let me give an example of these irreducible components, or one of these irreducible components when G is equal to six. So for every smooth cubic threefold, we can naturally associate an intermediate Jacobian with a principally polarized, actually, abelian variety of dimension five. With a natural theta divisor, a canonical theta divisor, which has a unique singular point, which has multiplicity three at the origin. Okay, so in particular, since the origin is a two torsion point, of course, the locus of intermediate Jacobians lies inside theta null. This divisor theta null inside A5. Okay, well, now we want to consider the preimage of this locus of intermediate Jacobians and compare it with the preimage of theta null. So if one wants to construct an intermediate Jacobian as a prim variety, the way is considering a line contained in the cubic threefold B. Okay, we consider a supplementary plane P2 in the ambient P4, so that this plane is parametrizing all the planes containing the line L. And what we are doing is projection from B into this plane. So simply what we are doing is, for every point of B, we consider the plane which is obtained from joining the point with the line. Okay, this is of course rational, it's not defined along L, but one can blow up. And this is a morphism. This solves the indeterminacy locus. Okay, well, essentially what we are doing, what are the fibers of this map? To every plane containing L, we're intersecting the cubic threefold with this plane, and we are considering the intersection. And the intersection is the line L and the residual point. Okay. Well, then the locus of planes through L is parametrized by this P2, such that this residual conic is reducible, so that it breaks into two lines, is a plane quintic associated to L, to this conic bundle structure. Okay. So essentially, to every point of this conic, what we are doing is considering the plane obtained from joining with L. And this plane intersects the cubic threefold in L and two further lines. Okay. Well, if we denote this plane quintic by QL, there is a natural covering QL tilde, let's call it, that essentially puts over every point of QL the two lines. The two residual lines arising in the intersection. And the prim variety of this cover is the intermediate Jacobian of the cubic. And this is all the possible ways one can construct the intermediate Jacobian as a prim variety. Okay. So if one considers the preimage of all the intermediate Jacobians, one has the locus formed by covers of plane quintics satisfying a parity condition. Okay. I mean, not every cover of a plane quintic arises in this way, but if one puts a parity condition here, then one recovers these constructions. We call it RQ minus, following the Donaghi's notation, I think. Well, then what happens is that this loci RQ minus is an irreducible component of the preimage of theta null. because RQ minus is not contained in TE6. Okay? Mainly because the general quintic has no semi-canonical tensor. So this is an irreducible component and has dimension 12, because the locus of quintics, well, the modular space of plane quintics has dimension 12. And this has indeed codimension 3 in R6. And indeed, we have a component whose theta divisor has a point with higher multiplicity. So this is all I wanted to say about the even case. Let's move to the odd case, TO4. And as I told you before, this map is going to be dominant, actually subjective, in contradistinction to the even case. The result is that this prim map restricted to TO4 is surjective. And actually the fiber, the general fiber of this map, fiber at a general Jacobian, is the complement in the projective plane of the union of the canonical model of X, which is a quartic plane curve, and the 28 B-tangent lines to this plane quartic. Okay. Essentially, the idea to prove this is to use Recilla's trigonal construction. This is an instance of the polygonal constructions that Irene already introduced this morning. The philosophy of the Recilla's trigonal construction is that if we have a double cover of a trigonal curve, then its prime variety is going to be the Jacobian of a tetragonal curve, and conversely. So the idea is that we have a double lethal cover of a trigonal curve. This is 3:1. This is 2:1. Then one can associate a tetragonal curve X such that the Jacobian of X is going to be the prime variety of this curve. And under certain generality conditions on the curve X, one can reverse this construction. Okay. So let's put it in a more sophisticated way, but the diagram is going to be the same. If we consider the moduli space of objects like the ones I consider here in the left, so we have a cover of a smooth curve of genus 4 that I will assume also that this is not hyperelliptic, and do it with a trigonal line bundle on the curve. We consider this moduli space. And on the left, we consider the moduli space of objects like the ones presented here. So we have a pair formed by a curve of genus 3 and a G14 on X. And I will assume it's base point 3 in order to give a morphism to P1. Okay, but the U14 must doesn't need to be complete. So then what Recilla's trigonal construction says is that we start with the moduli space parametrizing the objects in the left. If we forget the trigonal curve and we apply the prim map to the cover, then we are going to get the same abelian variety as if we apply Recilla's trigonal construction, forget the trigonal line bundle, and then we simply consider the Jacobian. Okay. Well, then the idea to find the fiber restricted to TO4 at a general curve X by this diagram that actually is an isomorphism. If we restrict to a certain open subset here, okay, then we have to leave this element to this curve X to this open subset, come back via Recilla's, forget the trigonal line bundle, and once we are here, intersect with TO4. Well, the method to do this is that we can consider two involutions sigma on both moduli spaces. I will not give the details because I don't want to be over time, but essentially the idea is that they commute with Recilla's trigonal construction. So R O sigma is tau O R. Okay. Well, the key point is that when we are doing all this way around in order to arrive here and intersect with TO4, once we are at this point of the moduli space, the preimage of this projection phi of TO4 is one of the fixed set of psi by this involution C. Okay, so since these involutions are compatible, it must come from a fixed loci by tau. Okay, and once we are in tau, this is related to the geometry of X, and here it's much easier to consider this fixed loci. Okay, totally, this fixed component corresponds to the G1 force, which are not complete on X. So these are parametrized by the projective plane, because the G1 force non-complete are contained in the canonical bundle. And then we have to discard the points of X in this P2 because they are giving base points in our G14. And we have to discard also the 28 tangent lines because are lying outside this open subset. Okay, so I won't write anything else about this. I'm sorry for the explanation. I can give you more details if you want, but this is more or less the idea. So now let me move to the case of Genius 5, which is probably the most interesting one. We want to understand how is the pre-map, the Bobille's proper version, if you want, of the pre-map restricted to TO5. Okay. First of all, let me say that Donaghy, in the description of these pre-maps, found a rational map between A4 and the moduli space of pairs formed by a smooth cubic threefold B and a two torsion point in its intermediate Jacobian, which has a certain parity condition. Okay, and this is actually birational. Izadi gave an explicit description of this birational map and found the indeterminacy locus. And somehow incidentally, during this study, one can find the following result of Izadi is that this pre-map restricted to TO5 is surjective. Okay. And actually, the fiber at the general element of this RC class is a partial desingularization of the curve of a curve in the Fano surface of lines of the qubit. Okay, so this is the Fano surface. And the curve that we are considering parametrizes lines such that when we are considering all the planes through L, there exists one such that the residual intersection is a double line, R. Okay, so with regard to the previous construction of the conic bundle, this means that the discriminant quintic has a point where actually there is only one point lying over it. There is a double line, two lines are somehow collapsing, and this produces a node on the corresponding quintic, but the cover is admissible anyway. Okay. The idea of the proof goes as follows. Donaghy described the fiber of the pre-map in general, not restricted to a divisor, at the general element of this moduli space birational to A4, as a double cover of the Fano surface of lines of B. This is what I denote by FB tilde. Okay, this is the 2-to-1 et al. Cover, which actually is defined by this two torsion point. So this is the information that gives the two torsion point. Well, one has the curve gamma inside the Fano surface of lines. And one can see that the preimage of this curve gamma by this double et al. Cover has three reducible components. One of them is the intersection of TO5 with this general fiber. So actually this component is the general fiber restricted to TO5, of course. And another component, which is the intersection of delta zero RAM, this is the divisor of bovine admissible covers of nodal curves. So here are curves of singular, of singular curves. And this is the intersection of this divisor with the general fiber. Okay. And actually, Donaghi's description of the involution here, exchanging sheets for the cover, which also was described alternatively by Zadi, both descriptions are very geometric and give that these two components are exchanged by lambda. Okay. So in particular, it follows that gamma must be singular because the Fano surface of a general cubic three-fold has Picard rank one. So then what you get is that the curve gamma is ample in the Fano surface. And if it's pretty much where smooth, then it should be reduced. Okay, this is a consequence of Hodge index theory. So gamma must be singular. The picture, you have to regard it as follows. We have the curve gamma. And here we have the two components. Some of the singular points of gamma lead to nodes of these components, but there are also singular points of gamma which actually lead to intersection points of the components. Okay, this is the reason why this general fiber, one of the two components, is a partial desingularization of the curve gamma. Okay, this is what.
Sorry, Andres, you have 3 minutes left. So
okay. I will finish. No. Thanks. So just the final part is we can obtain more information about gamma with analysis of the divisors with the divisor TO5. Okay. So we have this curve gamma. This is the definition. This is a plane with a residual conic, which is a double line. But in the same way, one can define a natural counterpart, which is a curve gamma prime. Okay, it's formed by lines R, such that there exists a two-plane which intersects the cubic three-fold in two times this line. Okay, this is somehow a natural counterpart. This is called classically the lines of second term. Okay, this is classically studied. This curve gamma prima is known to be smooth for a general cubic three-fold B, and also it's numerical class. And also one can, it's easy to prove that if, since the cubic three-fold B is smooth, then one has a natural morphism from gamma prima to gamma. Okay, because for every line R, one can only have a plane satisfying that the intersection along this plane is double for the line R. One cannot have two planes. So the situation is that the curve gamma prima is smooth, and actually one can prove that this is the normalization of gamma, which I told you that is always singular. And with a bit more of work, one can prove that the only singularities of gamma are nodes. Okay, and these nodes have a geometric meaning because these are the points which have two preimages in gamma prima by this normalization. So I will not make the picture, but you can imagine the situation of a line and two distinct planes with residual intersections double lines. Okay. So once we are here, a natural enumerative question is, what is the number of nodes of gamma for a general curve? So what is the exact number of lines satisfying this configuration? And one can prove that gamma is numerically equivalent to 8 times the canonical divisor, and we will deduce from it the number of nodes of gamma. Okay, I won't give the details of the proof, but only let me tell you that the way of finding this numerical class is somehow surprising, at least for us, because what we used is that Donaghi's description of the general fiber realizes this double cover of the Fano surface of lines in this moduli space of admissible covers, or if you want, in the Deligne-Mann for compactification. Now, the fact that this space has a well-known Picard group description, the canonical class is also well-known, allows us to find properties of the double cover, but also the Fano surface of lines, which somehow, if one tries to see directly in the cubic threefold, does cannot detect. Okay, so expressing this Fano as a general fiber allows to give more information also about the cubic threefold. It's not only to say things about the print map. Okay, and here one uses to prove this that the cohomology class of TO5 is well known, and one can compare it with the canonical class. Okay, using that we know the numerical class, we can compute its arithmetic genus. The geometric genus of gamma is that of gamma prime because these curves are birational. And computing this difference, the numerical class is quite high in comparison with that of gamma prime, one obtains that the exact number of nodes is 1,485. Okay, so if you want to translate these nodes into lines, there is this number of lines for a general cubic threefold satisfying this condition. Well, this is all I wanted to say, so thank you for staying here.
Thank you very much, Andres, for this very interesting talk. So is there any question? I have lots of questions, but maybe if you have some time tomorrow, I would like to understand better your beautiful construction based on the trigonal, Resilus trigonal construction. So maybe if tomorrow you can explain it to me, I will be very happy.
I will be glad to explain it. Thanks.
Okay. So any remark, question? Okay, so if not,
we're all a little bit tired, but that was a very nice talk. Both of the talks were very nice.
Yes, my compliments to everybody. Today's talks were very beautiful. Yes.